Good morning, welcome to this morning's family service. We're going to start with our first hymn. We will take the offering while we're singing this hymn. This is a hymn which is a sort of brings back memories for me of Wilsthorpe Road when I got a little bit of feedback or something. Wilsthorpe Road when it was a wooden hut and I was a little lad and I can remember singing this hymn here. I can't ever remember singing it, but I say this once or twice and then somebody corrects me. I can't ever remember singing it since we came back to Chad around 2012. But we're going to sing it this morning, so we're going to stand and sing Praise Him, Praise Him, Jesus, our Blessed Redeemer. Something that actually affords us, something that really stirs our heart. And there's a temptation to always go back to the same well-worn few. And I just found that one was playing on my mind this week. I don't know whether you ever find that, but it just kept coming back into my mind through Thursday and Friday. And I thought, shall I or shan't I? And I just felt led of the Lord to do it.
So anyway,
I don't make any apologies for it, and thanks very much. I think we sang it quite well. So we're going to come to a time of prayer. I'm going to start by giving thanks for the offering, then I'll open for any prayer. Lord, we just thank you for these offerings that have been given this morning, for your work and for the furtherance of your kingdom. Lord, we just pray that you'll bless them. Give us the wisdom to use them wisely, so that everything that is done with this gift will be to your honour and to your glory. We ask it in your name. Amen. Okay, have we got any prayer requests? Yes, Bob.
All of the children who did GCSEs will get the results on Thursday, which means for our church, that's Luke and Lizzie and Samuel and Sophia. I suppose it could be a stressful week. No worrying is going to change the results they get. Okay. Perhaps you could just pray that it goes well, or as God intends. Whatever happens draws them to God.
Right, I've got a pen that's not writing desperately well, but anyway. I'm making it do things. So, hopefully then, by the time we come to next Sunday, we'll be having a prayer of thanks for exam results achieved. But anyway, until Thursday, Sam, we're thinking about you anyway, and we hope it works well. And for Lizzie, and for Sophia, and for Jeremiah. Okay, Graham.
Could you pray that the Lord help us to deliberately be ready, to deliberately get ready, and suddenly with people we are mixing with, suddenly turn an opportunity for us to speak of our Saviour to them. To be ready, to be instant in season for that and not use it. I pray that because something happened to me this week and I've prayed to the Lord and he's given me something now to reply. But it makes me conscious we need to be ready at each instant.
Yeah. Okay. That's fine. Any other items for prayer?
Right. Oh, Gosha.
Obviously, can we pray for Ken's tomorrow visit to hospital? So they're going to check if everything is okay tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I think, can we pray also for our friends here who we haven't seen for a while, for Phil, Robin and Ryan,
yeah,
and Lizzie and Carrie, that God bless them and we protect them from any enemies that are stopping them to just be with him.
Yeah. That is good. Chad always did get a little bit quieter in August. I think there's probably, in some respects, not in every respect, because we do know that for Robin and Ryan, it's probably for other things, but we do know that it's a time when people are away holiday-wise. But for whatever reason, yes, certainly we will pray for them. I'm going to add one of my own that I think we should pray for. All of these people, there seems to be a whole swathe of countries from the Mediterranean and now Western Canada that are really suffering with wildfires, and it's been particularly horrendous this year. And people are losing their lives, people are losing their homes, people are having to leave their homes at the very least and come back and face the prospect that they've been destroyed. And it is really sad, so we'll bear people up. They're suffering with that as well. Okay. Let's come together in prayer then. Father, we just thank you for the tremendous privilege of being able to come into your house this morning. We just thank you for the freedom that we have to be able to come and to praise and to worship you. Lord, we just thank you for these songs of praise and worship that we're able to join in. We thank you for those that pen the words. We thank you for those that pen the tune, because they uplift our heart in praise and worship to you. Lord, we don't seek to worship the words, we don't seek to worship the song, the music. Rather, Lord, we just pray that they will be a vehicle that is honouring, that lifts our hearts
in praise and worship to you, because you are our Creator God. More than that, you are our Heavenly Father. You are our rock, you are our fortress, you are our salvation. Lord, we look to you, and Lord, we just pray that as we come into this place this morning, Lord, we just pray that first of all, your quietness. Lord, you know the things that have perhaps beset us during the week, the things that have maybe frustrated us, the things that have certainly kept us preoccupied. And Lord, we may not have come into your house this morning just immediately ready to come to a point of praise and worship. And Lord, we just pray. We pray for the power of your Holy Spirit, that it will still our hearts. Take away the things that have been stressing us, that have been preoccupying us during the week. Lord, we just pray that for the next hour that we will be able to just focus our hearts, focus our thoughts under the leading of your Holy Spirit on you. Lord, we just pray that you will pour out on each one of us this morning a blessing. Lord, we just pray for Sam and Lizzie and Sophia and Jeremiah as they face getting their exam results this week. Lord, you know the apprehension that comes from the long wait between finishing the exams and finding out what grades they've got. Lord, we just pray for each one. Lord, we pray first that you give them comfort, that you give them peace, that as they wait to get the results on Thursday, they will just know your peace. Lord, we just pray for good results when they come through. Lord, we just pray that the results will be honouring to all the work and all the effort that has been put in. Lord, we just pray that the results will be the results that are needed, that will enable them to move on to the next stage of education. Lord, we just pray that that will go well. We pray that where they seek to go for the next stage of their education, they'll be able to get in there, that the grades will support that, and they'll be able to get into the places of their choice. Lord, we just pray that you will pour out a blessing on Sam and Lizzie, on Jeremiah and on Sophia particularly, as we remember. Father, we just pray that you will equip us through the power of your Holy Spirit to be ready, to be equipped by the power of your Holy Spirit to give a word of testimony to those that we work with, those that we meet in our daily lives, those that do not know you. Lord, we pray that not only in our words, but in our whole way that we live our lives, we will be a witness that is honouring and glorifying to you. May people look at us and see your Son reflected in us, not through anything that we bring, because we bring nothing, Lord, but because of the outworking of your Holy Spirit in our lives. Lord, we just do pray that we will be faithful witnesses, that in a world that seems to get darker each day and seems to get more troubled each day, we pray that in being with us, those that we seek to minister to will see the Lord Jesus in our lives, recognize the difference and want to come to know you, who to know is life eternal. Yes. Pray for Ken as he goes for the hospital check tomorrow. Lord, we just pray that everything that was done in the surgery a couple of weeks ago, we just pray that it will have gone well. We pray that the healing will be going well. We pray that you'll overrule in that situation. Pray that the visit to the hospital will go well. You know that, Lord, sometimes hospital visits can take time. Lord, we pray that it will go well. We pray that the healing will be good. And Lord, we just pray for speedy and complete healing for Ken in that situation. Lord, we commit to you those that we haven't had the pleasure of fellowshipping with for the last few weeks. Lord, you know that there are several reasons. There are different reasons why this happens, Lord. And Lord, for whatever the reason, we think of Robin and Ryan and Nellie and the new baby, Lord, and we just pray that you will bless them. We pray that things will be settling down, that Robin and Ryan will be able to get into a routine with two children. We pray that Nellie will be able to cope with new baby coming on, we pray that all will be well with the new child, that she will settle to sleep in and to feed in and to gain weight and to just being well. And Lord, we just pray that you'll bless that little family. Pray for those that may be away on holiday, that maybe just are out on day trips, but for whatever reason, Lord, we just pray that you will bless them. We pray that you will minister to them, even though they aren't here with us this morning. Lord, we just remember each and every one of them. We think fondly of them. We just pray your blessing on them. Until we meet again, until we're joined again in fellowship. We think too of those that are suffering right across the world with the devastating wildfires. We think of the Mediterranean countries, Greece and other countries in the Mediterranean, the Balearic Islands, and now on the west side of Canada. Lord, we grieve for those that grieve. We grieve for those that have lost loved ones, for those that have tragically lost their lives in these fires. We grieve for those that have lost their homes and everything that they own. Lord, we just pray that you will, in your mercy, bring an end to this awful series of devastating fires. Lord, we pray that you will give the firefighters skill in fighting the fires. But Lord, we just pray that the weather conditions will soften, Lord. That the fires will be able to be extinguished and this terrible season will pass. People will be able to start to heal and to start to recover. So Lord, we just pray your blessing on us in this time together this morning. We ask it in your name. Amen. Amen. Okay, notices for this week. Fairly brief, unless I've forgotten anything. Somebody shout up and remind me if I have. Tuesday the 22nd, it's 7:45, it's Bible study. And it's entitled The Church Everyone Wants. It's the third study in the book of Acts, and it's Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. And because we've struggled with people being away at the moment, it's back at Sandy and I's house. Don't worry about getting infected with Sandy. She's not feeling brilliant. She's still suffering with a cough and cold, but I don't think she's too infectious. So don't let my good lady state put you off coming and joining us on Tuesday night, if you will. Next, there are no services on Wednesday, obviously, with it being holiday. So there are no kids club, no rock solid. Next Sunday, the 27th, 10:30, it's the family service in Morris Cleading. And the only other notice that I've got now, I've got two. One is an apology that I meant to print off some new invites for midweek or two, for September and October. I will do it, but I've had one or two problems with my PC, with my computer over the last few days. And it was all done to get things finished for the service this morning without loading myself with anything more. So I will get them done and printed, but they haven't been done. I had hoped to put them on the table at the back, but I will get those done and they will be available next week. And the other one is just again to remind you of the Fellowship Day at Pine Lake on the 30th of September. Please do put it in your diaries. Is it you and Buff that are collating? Yes, so if you're wanting to go, please let Morris and Buff know. And I think, to be honest, where are we? We're middle of August, 20th of August today. So I would have thought sometime over the next couple of 3 weeks we would be, yes?
What we'll need is to know any absolute dietary requirements, so not preferences, but we're going to die if you eat enough, that sort of thing.
Right.
And also whether you have a space in a car so that if somebody needs it.
Right, okay. So did you get that? Your dietary requirement isn't if you like food, because that's a given, and there's plenty of it usually at Pine Lake. It's if there is something that you can't eat, let us know, let Morris and Buff know. Let Morris and Buff know if you're going to come. Let Morris and Buff know if you've got any particular dietary needs that need to be met.
And let Morris and Buff know if you've got any space in the car and you can give somebody else a lift. Because we will arrange lifts for people from Chad to get across the plane lake. Because we won't leave you stranded there. If we take you there, we'll make sure. Okay. Right. So we're going to have one more hymn before we move on to the message. I think this has become, over the last few months, one of our favourites. Certainly one of mine. I couldn't remember, and forgive me, I couldn't remember whether we'd actually played it on the piano, but Morris assures me that we have and everything's fine. So we're going to stand and we're going to sing this hymn and then we'll have the message. Now then, For some of you that are perhaps a little bit more astute, and maybe are even interested in it, there was a certain football match being played at 11 o'clock on Wednesday morning. And even if football isn't actually your forte, I don't know whether you follow the England football team, and especially whether you follow the England ladies team. It's a sort of growing interest, isn't it? But the ladies don't seem to have quite made the interest that the men have yet. But they do play well. And of course, there's a certain game going on, even as we're in church this morning. And please, a request. If you've got a mobile phone and it blips up with a score, I do not want to know. Don't tell me the score. Because I promised myself that after I've had a great time with fellowship with you all and we've washed the pots and I've locked up church, I'm going to go home and I'm going to sit down and I'm going to watch it and I'm going to enjoy the moment and I don't want to know the score. Right, okay. I've even left my mobile phone on the desk at home deliberately so that it can't ping up because I get news alerts online. So, the reason I asked the question is that on Wednesday morning I was actually at the Royal Derby Hospital having a CT scan. Some kind soul rang me while I was walking Oscar on Monday evening. I was just coming back from Eyes Meadow to go back to the car, Duffield to go back to the car, and I got a phone call out of the blue. And I'm always tempted when it's unknown numbers to actually blank it, but for some reason I thought, okay, I'll pick it up. It's about 25 past six. And it was somebody from the X-ray unit at the Royal Derby Hospital inviting me to come in for a CT scan, which I needed to have, but to come in on Wednesday morning. So I accepted the appointment at 9:20, put Oscar in the cage in the car, climbed in the car, started the engine, and I thought, it's the England semi-final on Wednesday morning. No wonder I got an appointment for a CT scan. Everybody else would be missing it, wouldn't they? Having sort of had that thought, I then thought, well, actually, if the CT scan's at 20 past nine and the match doesn't kick off till 11 o'clock, and there it goes on the television at 10 o'clock, that's all the waffle that you have beforehand. I'm not bothered about that. It's the game we're talking about. I thought, well, if the CT scan is at 20 past nine, be out of the hospital for somewhere between 10 and half. Be home for half 10, quarter to 11. No problem. I'm fine. Alas. I thought, well, we'll get there early. I might even get in early. If nobody else is there having a CT scan, you never know. They might be running ahead. You ever know in a hospital to run ahead? No, didn't on Wednesday either. And they decided they weren't going to scan me in the main hospital. I was sent out to a trader in a car park. It's actually a very nice trader, very impressive. Once you walk in, you have got no idea that you're not actually in a hospital. But I got to, they inject you with a dye when they do a CT scan. And you'd tap in my arm, trying to get cannula into that arm, and it wouldn't work. Then he tried on that one, and it wouldn't work. Finally, he got it in the wrist, and then decided that actually I needed a blood test before I could have the scan. So decided that they were going to take me back into the main hospital. Back into the main hospital, see, X-ray unit. Lovely nurse, super, absolutely marvellous personality. But so laid back. The next stop was probably horizontal. She was so relaxed. She was really, really funny, really lovely natured. But nothing was going to be done in a rush. And my CT scan wasn't going to be done in a rush. And there were one or two dear ladies that were in front of me. Upshot was, by the time I got done and got finished, I didn't leave the hospital car park till 22:11. It wasn't much of a problem. I should still make it back for the start of the match. Except that, you know what happens when you're coming out of a car park, don't you? You've got to scan the QR code at the machine. And somebody couldn't reach across, so they had to get out the car to go and actually stand at the machine and do it, and run back in and get in and get out before the barrier came down. And there were about four or five cars in front of me. I thought, if everyone does this, it's going to take some time. And the time was ticking. Eventually, I got going. It was fine. The jam cleared. And everything did well until I was on about the last third line. Come up through Little Eaton Village, I was coming around the back of the golf club. Which one is this now? Bredshaw Priory, thank you. You know, I kept wanting to say Morley Hazen, and I knew it wasn't Morley Hazen, thank you. And there was a guy there with three travelling companions, and he was a dear old guy. And he was not going to go down that road any faster than 30 miles an hour. And he was not going to go down that road anywhere other than in the middle of the road, because it is quite narrow. If people drive well, you can actually get past. And I thought, well, I'm not going to try and get past him, because I don't want to. I'm going to run him and his companions off the road. But by this time, I was getting a little bit chompy. 11 o'clock was not going to be achievable. Then I felt the same. So you're going to miss the first 10 minutes. Nothing's going to happen in the first 10 minutes anyway. And you're recording it, so even if something did happen, you can always catch it. You can always catch up with it. Why are you getting impatient? At which point, I stopped, and not literally stopped, but I stopped my feelings of being frustrated and smiled. I got a plan. I got it all worked out. I got it timed in my mind to absolute perfection. I was going to be there and I was going to be enjoying a cup of coffee at the start of the match. God had a better plan. Because God was going to teach me another lesson in the art of forbearance, the art of patience. He's also going to teach me that his timing, as it always is perfect. Even if it's different to my timing, his is perfect. And he also gave me the intro to this morning's message as well, which is great, isn't it? So there was three bonuses that came out of that. So, to come on to this, fruit of the Spirit, forbearance. Is it just patience? Or is it something more? If we could go on to the next slide, please, Tom. Depends which version you read. Whether you regard it as patient. I just had a look in Bible Gateway. I know it's a program that Morris and I use quite a lot. I'm not sure whether Andy does, but I guess he probably does. It's really good for being able to cut and paste Bible verses and actually get them, search them on the internet very quickly. Really useful. So if you look at it in the New Living Testament, the Holy Spirit produces a kind of fruit in our lives that is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, fullness, you know the list. So the NLT very much sees it as patience. But if you were to go to the King James Authorised Version, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, and faith. But if you then go to the NIV, which is the one that we use mostly in this church, and I know other people use, some people prefer the King James Authorised, some people prefer the NLT and other versions, and that's absolutely fine. But if you go into the NIV, the one that we mostly use, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance. Now let's stick with the word forbearance, shall we? I like the word forbearance. I don't think patience actually really totally covers it. Patience is definitely a part of forbearance, but I think to just call forbearance patience on its own is not enough. What I want to do just for a few minutes is to just look at forbearance not as we might define it in a worldly sense, but forbearance as a fruit of the Holy Spirit. So there are three elements to it. We're going to do the first two, and then we're going to have a communion service, and then consider the last one. So moving on. Firstly, forbearance is part of who God is. It's an intrinsic part of God's character. God shows his forbearance to us, doesn't he? Because even though we were born in sin, even though we were dead in sin, even though we failed him so many times, he holds back the judgment that we deserve. He bears with us. He nurtures us. He cares for us. God is within his right to judge us the moment we sin. But he doesn't. In his grace and his love and his mercy, he holds off. And through that conscious act of loving forbearance that God extends to us, we can experience in full his mercy, his kindness, his love, his grace. But just as a caution, never think that God forbearing with us is God letting us off. Sin always has to have punishment. The choice we have is whether to accept the punishment that our Lord Jesus bore for our sin on the cross. As our punishment, and find forgiveness and peace with God. Or we can reject, or we can ignore God's forbearance. That will always ultimately bring us to a point where we face the God of justice. There is no other way. You can't blank God's forbearance and think God is going to let you off. You can wing it on the day. We are here, we're going to go into our communion service in a minute, because we remember that actually we don't need to come to that state. God in his forbearance made a way and patiently waited and prompted and led and encouraged us to come to that point where we confessed our sin and accepted the Lord Jesus as our sacrifice, as the sacrifice for our sin. Paul sums it up beautifully in Romans. Two passages I just want to read to you. Do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, that is God's kindness and forbearance and patience, not realizing that God's kindness is intended to lead you to repentance? That is the whole reason why God forbears. He holds off because he wants us to come to repentance. Then God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood, to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. All of us that have accepted Christ as our Saviour. But we're called to be the same. The fruit of the Holy Spirit needs to work through us in that same forbearance against those who wrong us. We all get wronged by people at some point in life, don't we? People say or do unkind things to us. The world will hold a grudge. The world will seek payback. We're to turn the other cheek. We are to seek to forgive them, just as God forgave us. Who wrongs us? It might be our friends,
It might be our family. It might even, God forbid, be a fellow brother and sister in Christ, because we are human, we're not perfect. And occasionally we rub each other up the wrong way. Paul's exhortation in Colossians 3, verse 13. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. That spirit of forgiveness and that spirit of forbearance is definitely a work of the Holy Spirit. So moving on. Forbearance, when we treat it as a fruit of the Holy Spirit, is also not reacting angrily when people say unkind things about us. Put your hand up, you don't have to do that much, but you can put your hand up in your heart. If you've never had somebody say something that is unfair or unkind about you. We all have, haven't we? Very often our reaction is totally understandable and totally human. We're hurt or offended by the accusation, particularly if it's an unfair accusation or it's an untrue accusation. And we are determined we're going to defend our reputation. We are going to right the wrong. That's what the world does. Totally natural, it's totally human. I've done it. I know, I can name the times, I can name times even recently when I've been tempted to do it, and probably have done it. I want to just read a passage just as we come into our communion service. The most powerful form of that forbearance that you or I will ever see. It is a fairly lengthy reading. We might clip it a little bit. But let's see where it goes. It comes, well, I'm going to read it from Luke chapter 23. And it is the run-up to our Lord Jesus being crucified. It starts in verse 1. And I am going to miss odd bits out, so I'm not going to read right the way through 41 verses, but we are going to go through it, and I'll go through it as quickly as I can, because I am conscious of time. Then the whole assembly rose and led him, that is Jesus, off to Pilate. And they began to falsely accuse him, saying, "We have found," the falsely is mine, by the way, "we have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payment of taxes to Caesar," patently untrue. Did he not say, "Render to Caesar what is Caesar's"? "And claims to be Messiah, a king." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "You have said so," Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no basis for a charge against this man. He was innocent." We know that he was innocent. "But they," falsely, "insisted, 'He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teaching. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here.' On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he'd been wanting to see him. From what he'd heard about him, and hoped to see him perform a sign of some sort. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer." The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently and falsely accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion.
I've examined him in your presence and I have found no basis for your charges against him. Innocent. Neither has Herod, for he has sent him back to us. As you can see, he has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and release him. But the whole crowd shouted, "Away with this man. Release Barabbas to us." Barabbas had been thrown into prison for insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" For the third time he spoke to them. "Why? What crime has this man committed?" "Innocent. I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty." "Innocent. Therefore I will have him punished and then release him." What Pilate was going to punish him for, I really don't know. But that perhaps says something about Pilate. But with loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified. And their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one that they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will. Two other men, both criminals, were led out with him to be executed. I've moved on a little bit. There's a bit in the middle that I missed out there. When they came to the place called the Skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right, the other on the left. Look at the forbearance coming out in this passage. False accusations. What did Jesus pray? "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." Jesus gave that act of forbearance for you and I. He was an innocent man. Notice how many times we recorded Jesus was innocent. Notice how many times he was accused falsely, unfairly, wrongly, unjustly. As Isaiah reminds us, as the lamb before its shearers is dumb, so he didn't open his mouth. He forbore the absolute injustice of the false accusations, the insults, the mockery, the ridicule, the pain. Why? Not because he deserved it, certainly not because it was fair, but because, as we touched on last time, he was looking to the joy of you and I being restored to the Father and coming to be with the Father and with our Lord Jesus in his eternal kingdom. That is why Jesus forbore those accusations, that cruelty, that mockery for you and I. I'm going to pause and to just reflect on that as we come to our communion service. And remember again, as we take the bread and as we drink the wine, the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. The body broken, the blood shed. The body and blood of an innocent man. Broken and the blood shed to free the guilty of the penalty of their sin, so that they may go free. That is forbearance. That is love. Let's give thanks for the bread. Lord. Lord, as we come to your communion table, to this service that you ordained on the night of the Last Supper, we take the bread as you instructed, and we stop and we reflect. We reflect on the injustice, the false accusations, the insults, the mockery, the revulsion of man. You who had done no wrong, crucified for me, that we may be free from the penalty of the sin that we so justly deserve, so that we may be clothed in the righteousness that is yours but is certainly not ours, Lord, except through faith in you, and except in love and wonder at the sacrifice that you gave for us. So, Lord, as we take this bread, we thank you for your body broken for our sin. Amen. Let's give thanks for the cup. Lord, as we continue this service, we come to the cup, the reminder of your blood shed to purge us from every sin, our open sins, our secret sins. There is not one that is not covered by your blood. Your blood's so freely shed that we might be fully, completely, and absolutely purified, washed clean, made whole, presented faultless through our faith in you, through our death to our sinful nature in you, to our new life in you, presented faultless before the throne of our Father. Lord, we come in remembrance and we come in grateful thanks for your blood shed for us. Lord, we take this cup and we remember that sacrifice, but Lord, we look forward. We look forward to that day when we will be with you for eternity, when the outworking of your sacrifice will be made complete and we will be forever in your presence, in the presence of the Father, in your kingdom for eternity. And we say thank you, Lord, and we say even so, come quickly, because we long to be with you. Amen. drink of the cup and remember the blood of our Lord Jesus shed for us. Final thing I want to think about, forbearance in a Christ-like way, because it's Christ that is our role model. It's Christ that we are, his character we're seeking to copy, but not through our own effort, but through the empowering of the Holy Spirit. So it's the forbearance that comes from Christ living in us through the power of the Holy Spirit. And that is in the sense of patient teaching. We're all at different levels, aren't we, when we come to where we are in terms of our faith and in terms of our relationship with God, in terms of our understanding of the Bible, of our understanding in Scripture. Some are further along the road than others, and hopefully over time we all mature. But just for a brief moment, I want us to look at how Jesus showed forbearance towards those that he was teaching, those that he was preparing. You know me well enough to know that one of the passages of the Bible that I really, really do love, and I don't make any apologies for coming back to it again this morning, is those lovely chapters from John 13 to 17. The reason that I love them so much is that it's an intimate moment that Jesus shared with his disciples immediately prior to his crucifixion. What Jesus was actually doing was preparing his disciples for a time when they would go out, not on their own, but go out empowered by the Holy Spirit, rather than walking side by side with our Lord Jesus. And for most of those chapters, it's very much Jesus preparing his disciples for that time. But they were struggling. We've got the benefit of hindsight. We know that after that, Jesus was going to go out. He was going to go across the Kidron Valley into the Garden of Gethsemane. He was going to be betrayed. And we know from what we read a few minutes ago what was going to happen. They didn't. In their heart of hearts, they didn't want Jesus to die. They heard the teaching, but they really just couldn't grasp it. Peter struggled to accept it, and we know the score on that. I'll just take a couple of examples. The whole of that series of chapters has actually got so much in it. I've just taken two. One is from John chapter 14, verse 8 to 10. And Jesus has just told them that he's going to go and prepare a place for them, and he's going to come back and take them to be with the Father. And Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, patiently, with forbearance, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I've been among you for such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, do I not speak on my own authority? I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work." That patient teaching, that patient discipleship, that patient growing of this group of 11 men. Remember that Judas had already left the room, preparing them. And then if we moved on to John chapter 16, verse 12 and 13. Here's the teacher understanding where his pupils are at, what they can and can't absorb. I can remember that at college. Thinking about school, Sam may have encountered it in school. We all probably encountered it in school. I can remember it encountering it in college. you couldn't get your head around something. You needed more time to get your head around it. We couldn't cope with it at the time. So the lecturer was actually very patient with us, and he took us down a different route to get us to understand it. Jesus says in these verses, "I've much more to say to you, more than you can now bear, more than you can get your head around, more than you can understand. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth." This is the work of the Holy Spirit, to guide us. He will not speak on his own, he will only speak what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. Again, in Colossians 3, Paul sums it up beautifully. "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion." This is Paul, as far as I'm concerned, speaking to you and I now. "Clothe yourselves with compassion, with kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has got a grievance against someone." What we read in. "Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity." That's why love is listed as the first fruit of the Holy Spirit. "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts." That is Paul encouraging you and I. That is how we should be behaving towards each other. How we should be behaving to the world as well. The world doesn't do forbearance. The world thrives on intolerance. It thrives on the cancel culture. Bearing patiently with one another is not the world's style. It doesn't do it. And it isn't our natural human position either. What Paul has exhorted us to do here only comes through the power of the Holy Spirit. When we allow that to happen, what it will show is such a marked contrast to the world that people will notice the difference. Graham asked in prayers earlier for us to be able to witness to those that we minister to. That might be a word, but it's also our actions. We can preach the gospel to people that we meet, but if we don't bear with them, if we don't show forbearance towards them, if we don't show love towards them, even when they hurl insults at us, even when they reject what we might say, we're still a work in progress. We still need the Holy Spirit to work through us. That spirit of forbearance. In closing prayer, I was going to do a final song. I'm going to leave it. It's a shame, but I really enjoyed it. So what I'll do is I'll put it onto the video, and I'll also put a link to it on the newsletter. But I think time's gone. So let's just close in prayer. I will tell you what the song is though, because it really was a beautiful version. Father, we just pray that as we come to the close of this service, Lord, we just help us, Lord, through the power of your Holy Spirit, to bear with each other, to forbear with each other. Lord, we're human, and we come with all the baggage to this, our being human. You know that sometimes we are treated badly, sometimes we're wrongly accused. Lord, you know that it is so easy to just want to actually defend their honour, to defend their integrity, to put people right. And yet, Lord, you gave us such an example of forbearance. You showed us your patient teaching.
of your disciples. Help us to bear with each other in patience and in love. Help us to minister to each other, to nurture each other, to grow each other. We are all sons and daughters of our Heavenly Father. We are being prepared to come into your eternal kingdom. And Lord, we just pray that through the ministry and through the working of your Holy Spirit, you will fill us with the fruits of the Holy Spirit, that you will make us each day more like you, so that others, seeing how we are, how your Spirit manifests itself through our lives, we'll be able to say, as the Roman centurion said, as you gave up your Spirit, truly, these are children of God. Lord, the Roman centurion recognized you were the Son of God. We thank God for that. Lord, we want those that we minister to recognize that we are sons and daughters of our Heavenly Father. We are brothers of yours, and we want to reflect your Spirit in all that we say, in all that we do, to those that we minister to. Bless us in the time of fellowship together. Bless us as we go our separate ways. Be with us until we meet again. Guard us and keep us. Keep us from the attacks of the evil one. We ask this in your name. Amen. Amen. The hymn that we didn't have, or the song that we didn't have, is I Will Wait For You, and it is Keith and Kristen Getty. It was a particular version. I know Morris has done it previously. Morris has done the Shame and Shame version. I spent rather too long last night. I had a rather naughty computer that was not behaving itself at all last night. And at 1 o'clock, I had to reluctantly put my hands up in the air and say, no, I can't do it anymore. I was trying to embed the words into this version of it. If I can make it work, I will add it in onto the video. I will certainly give you the link to it. If I make it work, I'll actually put it onto YouTube, onto the YouTube channel. So you'll be able to click onto the link to the song. But it's got an intro, and whatever the end it is, an outro, I don't know. Whatever it is, however it finishes at the end. It's just a little bit different to the Shame and Chain version, but it's really nice. But I just wanted to do it with the words. We haven't managed that, but we will try and get it to you during. God bless.
My sinful ways, how could I come? fix my gaze. I stand redeemed by grace alone.